You could have heard this episode 48 hours early on our Patreon, patreon.com/indieheadspodcast, by joining us for as low as $1 a month, or receive episodes early and gain access to our Discord server. All of our upcoming episodes will be available up on our Patreon 48 hours before it hits our public podcast feeds. But if you're hearing this via our Patreon feed, we want to thank you so much for your support. We especially want to thank our Real Ones patrons, including Boo Cannon, Rob Marino, Grant McSpooky, Dave Grohl, Darian Fisher, Cal 50, Al Grichmanoff, Melissa Redig, Lily Mikowski, Tony Serafino, Chris Wade, Selectric, David Colbert, Maze Farms, Bex, Georgia Mikowski, Rachel Hartman, Noah Kurtz, Waffle113, Alex Bilovich, Alec Felder, Adam Edwards, Jackson Crisp, Elizabeth, John O'Rourke, and Derek Pemberton. To become a Real One, consider supporting us with a $5 a month donation, where you'll receive bonus episodes every month and get a shout out at the top of the pod. Anyways though, enjoy the episode.
Doors and windows on. Motions on.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Death Grips Discog Breakdown. I'm one of your two co-hosts, Matty at Movie and Prince on Twitter. Of course, joined by my fellow co-host, Jackie, DJ Horse Jeans.
Hello, hello. Very, very thrilled to be here and very excited to be here with our guest today, because I wanted to save this till I was on the air because this is so great. Before we were recording, like obviously like right before we get on, I tried to like listen to the album again, listen to the music videos or whatever. And I was going up and looking for live footage of any of these songs. And I pulled up a video and was watching it for a good 45 seconds before I realized I was watching Natalie's concert footage of the Jenny Death tour. Of the when they played Up My Sleeves, which is one of the only times they've played it, but it was just so funny to be like, oh, let me see if there's any live footage of Up My Sleeves, and then was watching it for a whole minute before I realized it was the footage of the person who we have on today who can tell us about recording it. So
yes,
welcome to the podcast, Natalie, everyone.
Hello, it's me, at Natalie's Not In It on Twitter. And that's actually funny that you bring it up, because I actually we'll get into it at some point. I don't know how like immediately we want to dive into it, but like this entire era of Death Grips was like prime me being like fully in the trenches of like the culture and in like r/Death Grips. So like I have a weird sort of history with the fan culture, where like there are different lasting parts of like my legacy and like where I've been as a part of it that are just floating around out there that occasionally will just come back to haunt me every like year or so.
Yeah, I mean, no one has an uncomplicated relationship with the Death Grips fan base. That's impossible. But God, I'm so excited. Speaking of, talk about this.
I was gonna say, speaking of, so we're recording this episode like way far in advance. So by the time this is out, it'll be like weeks after I put up my Pace article, but like it went up, we're recording this on Tuesday the 27th, and my article went up on the 25th. So this is my very late address to any Death Grips fans that maybe found that article and then found the podcast. I stand by literally everything that I said. Year of the Snitch is a bad album, and you can find out why in a couple of weeks. So that's my statement.
I don't entirely endorse Maddie's takes, however, Hose Mad.
Look, you know, just the Death Grips fan base is not very happy with me, folks. They're not happy with me, but I'll still listen to that garbage anyways. But here we are. We're talking about, of course, Redacted on the Moon, the follow-up to Government Plates, and part one of the Powers That Be double album. And background-wise, not a whole lot we know about this record, both just because there wasn't really a whole lot happening with the band between Government Plates and this album. Basically, Zach Hill said on Facebook, hey, we're working on stuff, and also, like, I'm working on a film, and also I'm hoping to get some Hella stuff off the ground at some point soon. Of course, Hella stuff didn't happen. The movie didn't happen, but there was actual attempts to make it happen, but the album did happen, as we have part one of The Powers That Be, Redacted on the Moon. But before we get into that, Natalie, how did you get into Death Grips?
So my journey into Death Grips was a weird one, where they started to become a thing right when I was starting college, and right in the period of time where I was like heavy into like college radio. So I was doing a lot of like almost sort of like outsourcing research to like what was kind of big at the time and what was kind of like becoming like really buzzed about things on like music blogs. And I somehow managed, in the midst of all that, I think because of when I kind of started to get into it, like all the fervor around 2012, and it was only, I want to say 2013, when right around when there was the shows that were the no shows, and then there was the release of Birds, that just kind of came out of nowhere, were like the first things that I saw. And I'm almost certain that Birds was actually the first song by them I heard, which is, in retrospect, like a fucking wild way to get introduced to them. when Government Plates had dropped, I remembered that I had checked out that song and was, and went into it as my first album from them. Did not quite know what to think, as you could imagine a total newcomer to them would think of that being their first album.
Longtime fans didn't know what to think of that exactly. Album, so that's pretty fair.
I did like it more than like a lot of people did at the time, but I think that was also because I had a really open mind with those kinds of things. But after that, like, it wasn't something that like I loved, but it was like so enigmatic and so strange that I kind of felt compelled to keep going through, especially hearing people talk about their previous albums to the degree that they had. And so like a few months later, I dove into like what was part of the discography at the time and got like fully into it, and spent like the rest of 2013 into like the early parts of 2014, like really sort of obsessing over that, getting heavily involved in like the R Death Grips community, just researching the fuck out of like what was in all the stems, all that sort of bullshit. And then it was right around this album dropping that I feel like it felt like the first big release of theirs that I felt like I was a part of. And I know that we'll talk about our like histories and how we've been kind of like what this was for us, like when it dropped, but like I have a really fascinating like personal experience like with the exact timing of when this dropped.
Mm-hmm. Well then,
though this is the shortest Death Grips album, you can hear it in our voice. Like, there is simultaneously so much to talk about with this album, but it is so hard to like, where the fuck do we start besides the very beginning of the album? Because like, this is the most impenetrable Death Grips album ever. Like we talked about in the beginning, there's not a lot of context we have. It's the least amount of like information we have about this. There are no music videos for this album. Almost all of the songs in this album are not in the live tours, like for the Bottomless Pit tour and for the Jenny Death tour. There's not any they will play sometimes like the first verse of Up My Sleeves, but they don't do the rest of it. So I think that it is by that nature this like mysterious object in their discography. I think very intentionally so, like the way that it's produced, the way it's presented, the way that it's written by MC Ride. This is just the densest fucking 30-minute album I've maybe ever heard in my entire life. And I think that it is not my favorite Death Grips album. We'll kind of get into the things that I really love about it and the things that I really love this album in general. I think it's fucking incredible. I think there are very, very, very tiny nitpicks I can make here and there, but like, even still, this is a lean album. It's only 8 songs. Like, there's less filler on this album than there is on a lot of the other Death Grips albums, and it is so stream of consciousness, like continuous, even more so than Government Plates, I would say. The way that each song blends into the next one and shifts on a dime constantly, and the way that it all feels like this one fucking crazy 30-minute, just like, I don't even know how to describe what it's like to listen to this album. If you are listening to this episode, you haven't heard this album, I would just do yourselves a favor and like go listen to it, because it's going to be a lot of us going like, I don't understand how they made stuff that sounds like this. What is this?
Yes. So, however, it is Natalie and I's favorite Death Grips album.
Hell fucking yes.
It is.
I fully respect and admire.
Which, here's the thing. I will say this. It's most likely because it was kind of the first one that I was like really around for. Like, I was obviously around for like Government Plates, but like Redacted on the Moon, like that's where I was like, I was fully on the Death Grips train at that point. Like, I had gotten the limited edition. Well, actually, no, that was like a couple months later, where I got the limited edition, like Record Store Day, Government Plates. But I was fully on the train at this point. Like, I was like, okay, I'm in. Like, I'm a full-blown fanboy. And so this was like, holy shit. And one element also of, like, why this record is so underrepresented is also the fact that, like, at the time, critics didn't know what to make of it. I got a lot of lukewarm reviews. I think mm-hmm. the only place that was, like, giving it, like, decent, you know, reviews was, like, maybe Tiny Mixtapes. And even then, it was, like,
Before I was doing this, I was on the Metacritic page for Death Grips, and this album, Redacted on the Moon, has the second lowest Metacritic score of any Death Grips album, including Fashion Week and some other stuff. The only thing that is lower than Redacted on the Moon, Redacted on the Moon is a 70, and the only thing that's lower is Year of the Snitch, which is 69, which is perfect, I think nice. In many ways.
It's the only time nice. I'll say nice in the context of Year of the Snitch.
Hey, we'll discuss. we'll get into that.
That's for a couple episodes from now.
But yeah, you're totally right. Like the people did not know what to make of this album, and in some ways, I understand. I think a lot of what turned off critics by this album, as we were kind of just talking about a little bit next week, is this is the point where some people get sick of the bit, get sick of the provocations, and then this album comes at that point in that cycle where there's a little bit of that backlash happening, and this is the least listener friendly Death Grips album ever. So, like, if you're being bombarded with Death Grips culture, you're being bombarded with all these people talking about it on the internet arguably too much. You could very much argue we are contributing to said too muchness, but like they were everywhere at this point in time, post Government Plates, post No Love Deep Web, post Money Store. Like, this is towards the peak. We're reaching the apex of Death Grips fandom. And when you combine that kind of ubiquity with an album that is so unwilling to give over to you what it like, it is so enigmatic and so difficult to wrap your brain around, that especially for album reviews, like when you're writing reviews for like a major publication, you're probably having to churn out a lot of reviews all the time, and like this is the kind of album that really suffers from that, because if you've only got like however much time in the week, and maybe you've got to listen to three new things that you're going to have to write a review about soon, and you're trying to wrap your brain around everything that they're jamming into this 30 minutes of material, it's just like, it's really hard to, and I personally, my personal history with this, I liked this album when I first heard it, but I was closer to the, I don't know what the fuck to make of this reaction than the like, I'm bowled over by this album and think it's a masterpiece. And I have over the years creeped closer and closer to it's a masterpiece.
Yeah. So my personal history, kind of getting into it, because I feel like it's also probably important to explain like kind of the attachment that I had. I remember, just because as we've been talking about, it is so unique and so fucking jarring to hear, even in the context of other Death Grips albums. I remember being kind of mostly just unsure of what to think of it, other than just kind of being impressed by the fact that it was a thing that existed for a bit of time. And I feel like I really only kind of came around to it to the extent I did a couple of years later, more than just being bowled over by it. But like the timing of when this came out is like especially interesting for like where it happened, where I was when it dropped, just because this was, as I'm sure we've gotten into at the stage with how you've discussed them. Surprise release out of nowhere. They dropped it, said that the second half was coming. And while this was happening, when it dropped, I was quite literally on a study abroad trip in Rome and like had no fucking internet connection and like mooched off of my like hotel's lobby's like shitty Wi-Fi to like download this like measly 30-minute album, and then spent like days just wandering around a absolutely punishing heat wave of like over 100 degrees, walking around a cemetery that was like right outside of the like hotel that we were staying in, and just like listening to this over and over and trying to make sense of it. And like the stuff that like we have been like studying and like talking about in terms of like going to different like cathedrals and art museums too had just like a really uncanny parallelism to some of the lyricism on here. So like when there are like references to things like Romulus and Remus and like Stigmata, it was like one of those like weird out of body experiences where it's like you hear something so frequently in your everyday life that you're kind of like, it feels like a glitch in the matrix that somebody else is talking about them at the same time. So it's something about it, like this album always kind of like feels inherently tied to that, like for my experience, just it feels like it's very much of a place and a time in my life.
Yeah, I have that, like there are a couple albums that either I listen to for the first time while somewhere like on vacation somewhere else, or like listen to like just a lot while I happen to be there, and that kind of a sense memory with a completely foreign place can like make that album just like stick in your craw in a completely different way, because you've got all that stuff to, and you're right, like this is simultaneously it takes everything that was going on with Government Plates of like the sonic experimentation and the fragmentedness and the vocal samples, and we'll get into the secret, not so secret MVP of this album, but like the way that this is building off of what was going on tracks like This Is Violence Now and Big House and stuff like that, but it is taking that and combining it with that album had less MC Ride than ever. This is like the most writing MC Ride packs into a single album, which is crazy because it's like so dense instrumentally, and then on top of that you've got MC Ride at his most like literary. He's making references to Mary Shelley and Romulus and Remus and like all, and then the subject matter of this album, as I'm sure we'll talk about, is easily the darkest Death Grips album ever, I would say. It's really bleak, and a lot of people like talk about On GP and they're like, wow, I can't believe Death Grips made this song about suicide, like it's crazy, this is so different from them. And it's like, first of all, not only did they just make a whole album about suicide called Redacted on the Moon, but there almost isn't a Death Grips song that in some way could not be described as about suicide. Like, I mean, when you watch the Full Moon Death Classic video, before the video starts, not on not on streaming websites, but on the video specifically, there's a little clip that plays that where someone says, "We are preaching our own funeral as we go through this life. Don't forget that." And that's the first thing that starts Death Grips. So like they the stuff that they're talking about in this album is not a left turn the way that it kind of felt like in the moment, and the way that in general the powers that be dealing with suicide in a much more direct, like impossible to ignore kind of way. Like I think a lot of people reacted to that, but I think that's run throughout their music. But in the earlier stuff, there's that like full bot intensity and the poppiness and like all of the stuff that like makes the Money Store Special kind of distracts from that darkness. And this album does not do that at all. It like submerges you head first in it in a really, really intense way.
Exactly. But let's just dive in. So let's play a little bit of Up My Sleeves. For the listeners at home.
Up my sleeves, up my sleeves, up my sleeves, up my sleeves, up
Oh god, just it's so ominous off the bat.
It's probably the best. It's the best Death Grips opener. It is like the Doors and Windows On, Motion Sensors On is so perfect, and then just how do you even?
Yeah.
He's like coming in with like a buzzsaw bass, and you have the Bjork samples already kicking in.
The thing that like how is the Death Grips album with Bjork samples not my favorite Death Grips album? Like how is that even a possibility? Like it is so appealing to exactly my bullshit. Oh my god. And this is my favorite use of Bjork on the whole album. The way that the vocal goes up as the synth comes down, like in the second half of the measure, and like that keeps going up and down throughout the whole track, and it's so effective.
Yeah, it creates such a weird, intoxicating swirl to just start things off. I think it also it's very indicative of kind of a preparation for how they want you to approach this album. As like abrasive and confrontational as it is, it immediately marks itself for its difference compared to like pretty much every other Death Grips opener, where there is that abrasiveness, there is that confrontationalness, but it's laced with this sort of like vulnerability and paranoia and fear and sense of mortality that I feel like is very present throughout the rest of the album in such a way that even when it kind of gets away from it, you can feel like the sort of ripples of it in like how Ride is writing and describing all of these other sorts of things that are going throughout.
The writing on this song is fucking unbelievable. Like the whole first verse and then into this, the first I've Always Known section, like that first moment when the stuttering little drums and the Bjork sample kicks in and the I've Always Known, it's just the most fucking haunting thing I've ever heard in my life. This is one of my favorite Death Grips songs ever, and is the one song on this album that I like. I am all the way to the level of stand-in that you are for this, for sure. Like this, I think this song is just incredible, and every single section of it keeps adding to the intensity. Like we're about to get to this second verse here, where if you thought that first verse was intense, like verse two and then especially verse three of this album, just the song keeps escalating and keeps stepping up the energy level past what you thought was already like the peak. And it's the best, like one of the best MC Ride performances, one of the best instrumentals they've ever, it's just incredible.
Yeah, especially the ways that this particular set of lines we're about to get to here is there's still that sort of fervent passion and like intensity going throughout it, but there's a sense of openness and pain to it that feels especially raw compared to it, especially with the lines that he's talking about here that's about to come up with his dead mother. Is just something like that has never come up in a previous Death Grips song and has never really come up afterward, and it's just kind of very sort of disorienting moment where you're like knocked back by the sort of honesty of talking about this specific thing among all of the different things that Ride has talked about in the past.
Yeah, this verse is one of my favorite MC Ride verses ever, for sure. Like the performance and the writing to combine. Oh, that whole part that I should be worried, I'm temporary, pay no mind, illogical, just don't die in a hospital. Oh, by my disease.
Oh. I also want to, one other thing that I'm sure I'll bring up plenty is that actually sort of sitting with the lyrics for the first time in a while, because typically what I do is so much of this has been like committed to memory that I'll just like throw it on and I'll have most of it memorized. But like one of the things that I noticed is in the end of the first verse, he does this bit where he's like, I'm a wretch Maya. And it like, people have pointed out it's kind of a tie into what he does with the like repetition that goes on in Big Dipper too. And there are lots of little like kind of synchronicities with like the lyrical constructions and imagery throughout this that I think are just really sort of fascinating to like pick apart.
Oh, There were so many things I wanted to say during all of that, but also I just wanted to listen to it because it's just so, it's undeniable, I think. And anyone, like, some people still don't like this album. Some people didn't like this album at the time. I think Up My Sleeves is a pretty undeniable achievement of the band and is a song. I understand why they only play the first verse live. Like, the second and third verses is some of the rawest, most personal, most frightening lyricism that MC Ride has ever had about, like, and like you're saying, it acknowledges him as a real person in a way that the ex-military stuff and even the No Love Deep Web and Money Store, like, none of that was ever this kind of raw and vulnerable in the way, like, MC Ride is always sort of playing a character, and you really feel that wall kind of come down on this album more so. I mean, like, certain songs, like, he'll dip back into it, obviously, and, like, he's never in one continuous mental state for an album. Like, he's always fracturing and shifting, and different versions of MC Ride are appearing on every song. But, like, I think this is easily the most he's ever let his guard down in terms of putting, like, his real life pain and mental illness and thoughts about suicide and the end of his life and all that sort of stuff. And this first song, like, sets the template so perfectly for that theme.
Yeah. right off the bat, something that I want to kind of establish with this being the first song that I'll dig into as we kind of, like, touch on songs, I think, deal with that, because I think you're totally right, Jackie, that a big thing to sort of mention is that there are these connective thematic tissues to each of the albums and, like, overarching themes, but there's never one specific sort of, like, thing or idea that, like, Ride is trying to accomplish in any of these albums. He, like, so much of his lyrical style works in these sort of multiplicities and, like, taking on these different fractured identities in the songs, but, like, I feel like where that's especially fascinating here is that where I've started to kind of, like, warp my brain to this album and, like, how I've started to make sense of it as, like, a cohesive project over the years is sort of looking at a number of these songs, not the whole thing, but, like, a good number of them, as almost these sort of, like, avoidant coping mechanisms through, like, trauma and pain and, like, all of these ways in which through, like, traumatic shit he's trying to either escape himself or his thoughts or the events that are surrounding him. And I think that something like this, where you have right off the bat the sort of, like, the different emotions and, like, circumstances that he's dealing with, really set the stage for him to just kind of, like, take that idea and fucking run with it for the rest of the album.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Because, yeah, I mean, this song especially, but really the entire album, it's sort of like, you know, like, it's sort of like kind of trying to start that usual Death Grips mode, like, this very, like, abstract imagery. But, like, what makes this album and this song especially so special is the fact that, like, it's just there's these hard cuts to reality that come in, you know, in between this, like, abstract imagery. There's just these very sudden and very hurtful, like, reminders of, like, what the reality actually is. It's just, like, you know, terracotta armies and all this stuff. It's like, no, my mother's dead. Like, she's dead and I'm grieving her. And then, like, I think the interlude, like, I was reading the lyrics as the song was going, and I was, like, my eyes were, like, watering, you know, just, like, thinking about that being, like, you know, blank obituary in the cemetery, you know, just being completely unremembered, just a completely unmarked grave. No one remembers me. I have not made an impact. And that's, you know, almost feeling that's almost the preferred way to go out, with no one knowing who I am or who I was, you know?
Yeah. And that, like, immediately, Broadway Cemetery, they're talking about a specific cemetery in Sacramento, which I'm pretty sure is what is on the album artwork for this album, where MC Ride is walking through. So, like, it's very clear, like, right up front, like, this album is the band is called Death Grips. Like, death is not exactly not on the other Death Grips albums, but it is, like, it's front and center here. And yeah, that interlude, especially the way that all of the instrumental drops out of that moment, and you're really hearing, like, there the moments on this album where it's just MC Ride's, and this is really the only point from, like, here on out where you really get those, like, kind of moments of quiet and reprieve, because almost the whole rest of the album, even though it does, you're right that it will, like, make these left turns into real life and real shit in a way that some of the other Death Grips albums don't do, but like it's just so it from here on out it becomes so dense and so like so hard to even like make your way through. Like the instrumentals start to reflect MC Ride's like fractured mental state in a way that is like I think really effective. But this also sets up the whole instrumental kind of language of the album, the way that like the Bjork samples are introduced in the two different ways. And one of my things about this album, one of my small critiques, is I think over as the course of it they sometimes start recycling the same sort of ideas and uses for Bjork, and like I feel like a couple of them it just sort of feels like they're repeating the same sort of basic idea. But I think right off the bat, like the two different ways it's used on Up My Sleeves, with like the longer stretched out one and then the fast skittering one, is like so cool the way it teaches you like, okay, we have, in the same way that MC Ride's voice was being manipulated and pitched and chopped up on the last album, they're basically doing that with Bjork here, and then layering on top of that all of these super dense MC Ride verses. And it's just so much to take in on first glance, but the more time I spend with it, like the more I sort of grow to appreciate all the little details in both the Bjork vocals throughout and in MC Ride's vocals. I mean, in the Pitchfork review, which is not a good review, the one nice thing I remembered from it was that they included Bjork's quote that she gave after the album dropped, and she went online to confirm to everyone, yes, that's me, Bjork, on that album. She says, "I adore Death Grips, and I am thrilled to be their, quote, found object," which is one of the most Bjork quotes of all time. But it's also true. Like, that is what Bjork is on this album. She is not a featured artist. She is not, like, she is singing on every song, but her singing is being chopped into completely unrecognizable, almost non-human forms. But then in sudden moments, like most of the time it's chopped up so much you can barely even recognize it, and it's in the mix of this cacophony. But then there will be moments where it cuts through and you're like, oh, Bjork, like famous recording artist Bjork, whom I love and would die for, there you are. And it's so cool the way that they do that they tease it out over the course of the record, and they use it as this constant motif throughout. It's one of the things that makes this album feel so cohesive.
Yeah, let's dive into Bjork a little bit with her history with the band, just like very briefly before we get to the next track. Mm-hmm. So Bjork has been a long time supporter of the band. Pretty much she's a day one. Okay, she's day one with Death Grips, as I think when we talked about this briefly during the No Love Deep Web episode, but like Bjork was like one of the only people that like reached out with like positivity towards them during the whole thing where they canceled, like between the Money Store and No Love Deep Web, where they canceled their tour and all that. Like, she was one of the only people that reached out, was like, hey, I love you guys. Like, you guys are doing great. Like, I, you know, a nice email that Zach's like, I barely check my emails, but Bjork emails me, you know, I'm reading that. And then also in 2012, they did two remixes for her, for the Biophilia remix album Bastards. Both of them are very good. I think one of them, it sort of goes back and forth between like using Full Moon Death Classic, yep, and System Blower. The other one, what song are they using as like the basis for the remix? I couldn't figure that out at all.
I think Thunderbolt might be original and not. Yeah, you're 100% right that the Sacrifice remix uses the drums from Full Moon Death Classic and then the big synth drum bass hit from System Blower, and it's so cool to listen to because it's using like. It's probably like Zach Hill doing it pretty much himself, but it's not a Zach. It's a Death Grips remix, not a Zach Hill remix, because they're taking other Death Grips songs that like exist and folding them into this Bjork song in a way that completely recontextualizes them, and suddenly like Death Grips becomes a lot more accessible with Bjork, because Bjork has a voice that is not similar to MC Ride in terms of characteristics, but is similar in the way that it can like cut through an instrumental, the way that she can wrangle an instrumental that is very experimental and very like all over the place and can like bend it to her will, and just the amount of the range that she has and the raw character that her voice has is like there's no one else in the world who sounds like Bjork. So it's a really interesting idea to be like, well, she uses her voice as an instrument on every single song that she makes, but why don't we take her out of the context of her own music and put it into our world and like fracture it and deconstruct it and break it down until it becomes this really, really cool thing.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And so Bjork, again, fans, there's also a video of Bjork playing guillotine during a DJ set, during like a class reunion, and she screams like right as the song kicks in, which is awesome, and it rules.
Yes.
So
I do want to say something real quick, just bouncing off of something that Jackie said about like the Bjork samples, and like I totally get that. I totally get the sense of like, especially the fatigue that might creep in with like hearing some of the samples being used again and again. I just wanted to like position just as like a little counterpoint to me. That's honestly become something that's been especially fascinating to me. Like the more and more I sort of like learn about like how drumming operates and the sort of like different permutations one can make with it is I almost sort of the more that it has sunk into my brain that these are samples on this album being triggered by like V drum hits and like played in real time rather than like being sequenced is just it makes the sort of like close attention to them even more fascinating to me, because I start paying attention to them less as like sample beat grids and more like drum beats and like trying to map out like where on the kit like each sort of thing is. And if you listen closely enough, sometimes you can hear like certain cymbal or like drum head hits hitting at the same time as like certain samples, and you can kind of start to like pick apart like doing autopsies of each track and like how the samples are being doled out and how Zach Hill must be playing them. And that, honestly, to me, that makes it even more fucking impressive, just hearing how this album is being constructed as you are listening to it.
Mm-hmm. I feel like it's just gonna be like overdubs on overdubs, honestly. Like that's what it feels like at time here. But it's Zach Hill though, so it's like it could be overdubs, but also like he could just be playing all that, because Zach Hill is an insane person and is an insane creation by God, who was put on this earth for one thing and one thing only: to be a drummer and to put together the sickest drum parts ever to be conceived. But the sickest drum part is not until about halfway on the track list, but let's play the end of Up My Sleeves into the next track on the album, Billy Not Really, which guys, any verse is so fucking awesome too, by the way. I was Up My Sleeves,
every single verse of Up My Sleeves is good.
God, it's yes. So the transitions on this album are so fucking good.
Moves so fucking smoothly.
Specifically, that transition, the "Say Hey Kid, Have a Sad Come" transition, and the "Voila Big Dippers" is also pretty good. But like in general, those two, the 1-2 and the 4-5 of the album are like so great and build off of that. Strength of Government Plates. Oh, yeah. This part too.
Yes. I also want to throw my hat in for Billy Not Really to Black Quarterback, just because the two songs feel like two sides of the same coin. They almost kind of feel inseparable to me for like the way that they kind of like go into each other and have similar sonic palettes. Okay, so the one part that I wanted to point out that passed the whole verse about him going to the medium and saying "she scares me" is, I think, one of the more unexpected moments of this album if you have like listened to the past Death Grips albums, just because Ride on all of his verses casts such an intimidating like form and presence, and then you just have this verse where he's like, "this person I came across scares me," and you're like, who the fuck is scaring you?
That's a good point.
Yes.
It becomes one of those things where it becomes clear, like, how deep the sense of, like, fear and vulnerability is, like, seeped into the album.
Mm-hmm. it's just, yeah, you can't imagine someone, you can't imagine MC Ride being afraid of somebody. And I think it also ties in with, like, you know, what they've said about their music being, like, you know, their comments of, like, masculinity, where they're very much of, like, our music, like, is, like, androgynous. Like, there is no, like, macho masculinity. You know, it's androgynous. And that kind of really, you know, sets him to this record, being, like, you know, you might think this, you know, this is, like, super macho, which, like, you listen to, like, Noah Deep Web, like, why would you think that this band is, like, anywhere near macho? Like, that record is horrifying at times in terms of, like, the male experience.
Yeah, when they're portraying, like, guys being dudes, depiction is not equal endorsement. Like, they are constantly, like, creating these. A lot of their most aggressive tracks are, like, this is this hellishly masculine thing that is intentionally highlighting, like, what's wrong when you go all the way in this direction and how horrifying it can be. And but there's, it's this one is one of the ones that has gained in my esteem the most as I've been listening to it this week and as I've been listening to this over time. Like, the way that it combines, like, the kind of techno stuff that was going on like Lil Boy and Big House, but filters it through this insane Bjork vocal sample kaleidoscope, and then it flips into those sections where the drums like go halftime, and there's the, like, flute samples is what that, I don't even yeah. know what, I don't know what the hell
I this mean is. You know, it's Bjork, she's on her flute shit.
I would really love if, along with all the vocals, Bjork's like, oh, here's some flute, it's me playing some flute, you can fuck around with these too.
That must be what it is kind of the sort of way I've come to terms with it. But also, like, that part where it goes into, like, the sort of, like, double time gallop, especially, like, the other thing that, like, I really come to, like, appreciate this album for is, as we've been talking about, it is very lyrically dense, but I feel like it does so in service of this very sort of strange, almost kind of, like, abstract poetic quality to it, where there is just one of my favorite things to do over the years has been sort of, like, sitting down with any given song's lyrics and just sort of, like, annotating them out, like, taking the sort of, like, poetry analysis I was doing in college onto something like that. And that section where it really sort of kind of works over time at that is one that, like, is especially rewarding, just because so much of it is placed on this emphasis of driving these very seemingly unconnected but, like, thematically tied together lyrics and references to, like, Harmony Korine films, where, like, Werner Herzog is there doing seeing magic tricks and saying somebody has something up their sleeve, and, like, but also really sort of, like, paying such close attention to their, like, phonetic quality and the ways in which the rhyme schemes and, like, internal and slant rhymes are working is just it's phenomenal, that entire section.
Jackie, what was the film that Jade referenced in the ex-military episode?
Oh, Penelope.
Okay, we know MC Ride likes two films at this point. We know that he likes
Julian
Penelope.
Donkey Boy and
MC Ride has seen two movies. He has seen Penelope and he has seen Julian Donkey Boy. Canonically, these are the only two movies that we know of so far that MC Ride has seen.
Also, and I think it would be important to note that the genius, like, what you're saying about the poetic lyrics, like, the genius annotations for this album specifically are the most unreliable and debated
of any of it.
Like, there are so many lyrics where you'll click on it and you'll read the first annotation of, like, someone's interpretation, and then the first comment will be someone with more upvotes being like, no, it's not this, you dummy. But I should note that the She Tune In Telly Through Your Shriveled Button Pressed Jaundice Yellow, some people think that is a reference to the film Kids and the character Telly in the film Kids, where on the poster of Kids, Telly is the character that is yellow. So I think that there's at least one, if not two, Harmony Korine references in this song alone, which is king shit. And also, of course, Death Grips watch Harmony Korine movies, like, duh.
MC Ride has seen three films. He has seen Penelope, Julian Donkey Boy, and Kids. But on a more serious note, with this
we're
song,
starting
though,
we're starting to piece together the puzzle. Like, we're starting to figure out why he's like this.
MC Ride, again, put him in the Beach Bum too. All right, Harmony, hit him up. But serious. But on a serious note, with this song, like, The end lyrics of like, let me scroll down, of she's your experience, you're her experiment, her vox limbo fine print ob sharpie so sorry falsetto, which that second part I don't know what the fuck that means. And honestly, that's the thing, and that's kind of the beauty of this album, is that like, as I said, it's just these like completely abstract phrases that you're like, you can't wrap your brain around it, but then it cuts in with like a really hard bit of reality of like, oh, like completely, like, you know, completely throwing you off and then suddenly throwing you back into the fire. It's,
yeah,
it's just, it's magical stuff. And then also like going from like the vice versa of she's your experience, you're her experiment, to you're her experiment, she's your experience. Like, MC Ride, all right, if you've learned anything from the Death Grips discography, MC Ride has a lot of weird feelings going on about sex. There's a lot of weird shit happening in his head when it comes to sex. Like, this was definitely, you think, like, Know of Deep Web was like mostly about all this like weird psychosexual shit, and this is like that, but like even more intensely and more like, okay, if you didn't get it the first time, hey, shit's fucked up in my head, guys, when it comes to this.
If it's not clear, I'm gonna make a song called Have a Sad Come Baby, and then you'll understand.
Exactly. And also, we were talking about the GM's interpretations. Like, half the fucking interpretations are like, this is about the fans. And it's like, yes, but like, no. Like, like Death Grips have all, like, they're, you know, they've been very aware of their audience. Like, that's one thing about them, is that they're extremely aware of their audience and how they interpret them. And so it would not surprise me if there's stuff on the song that is about the fans. But sometimes it just feels like a cheap, like, all right, come on, you guys, we're just having some egos about ourselves. Like, come on, guys.
Like, not everything is about you.
Not everything is about us, okay? It's not about me. It'd be fun. It's fun to think that way. It's fun, but, you know, it's not always about us. But yeah. Unless we had any other thoughts, let's just keep rolling into this.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll play a little bit of the end of Billy Not Really into Black Quarterback. Which, like, the Bjork samples here, just, like, this, like, repeated, yeah, like, club, just, like, what the fuck is going to happen? It's just building to something.
Yeah, like, with the lyrics and the instrumental, you can never feel what to expect next, because, like, it can go from abstract to really, really personal and cutting at a moment, and also the instrumental can shift on a dime at any moment. Like, that club beat right into this beat is, like, what the fuck? And this whole first verse is so...
Yeah, this is, for the longest time, been, like, the one that honestly, like, I'm honestly too stunned by how the lyrics are put together on this one to, like, really kind of pick it apart. Just because so much of this first verse is just loaded with a lot of really descriptive, almost sort of hyper-specific, like, extreme close-up imagery that it becomes almost kind of difficult to get the full picture of what's going on. It's these, like, small, little, like, brief, like, one-second snippets of things that are happening in this kind of delirious haze. But it's, once again, just kind of goes to show just how much is going on under the hood of this thing.
Absolutely. Like, this is an unbelievable, it's like a story song a little bit, like Clink, where it's clearly, yeah, like explaining this encounter he has with the police. But the genius thing about this album in general is that, like, all the very personal, real life rooted stuff is submerged in the abstraction. Like, you can't fully follow the story because the one detail in the story will blend into some other image that's, like, floating around in his subconscious. And it really does feel like you're inside his head, and all these things that are happening are not, like, something that's playing out in real time, but rather, like, a narrative and, like, memories that are, like, floating through his subconscious with all the other, like, weird sex stuff going on in there, and all the trauma, and all, and, like, in blood, and all the stuff that he is in his art and his painting and his poetry, and it's just all there, like, and it can be hard to figure out, like, there's clearly, like, themes that run throughout the album that he keeps hitting on over and over again, but trying to take one individual song and be like, okay, what is going on here, is so fucking hard.
Yeah, that's the other thing that I wanted to bring up, is that, like, so much of the flow of the images really feels intentionally disconnected, or like it's like almost sort of like out of continuity or skipping over moments to the point where it almost feels more like free association than a story song. And like, to what Jackie was saying, like the sort of framework of it being something similar in like setup to something like Clink, but then like completely warped into this like abstracted experimental collage of images is like really the only sort of way you could take a song that is so that can be like concretely ascribed to like a situation and put it through this album's lens.
Absolutely. I also I really would like to shout out the line on the bridge where he says in over our heads and sinking autobonning Wonder Stevie faster comrade winking.
Yes.
Oh, God, that's great.
I'd also like to point out just because I had to throw in as many like poetry terms as I could into like my notes, but like I especially love that the first verse is that just haze of free association that almost kind of doesn't really seem to have a set scheme, and then they completely upend it by having the second verse that has this repeated epistrophe that ends every single line by cutting it off at the word the, and so you never really get like a complete sentiment until you get the very end of that verse, and you just kind of get this repetition that like just drives the rhythm behind the vocals.
Mm-hmm. This song, yeah, it fucking rocks. Like it's just, it's probably the most like explicitly banger song on the album.
I disagree strongly. Actually,
I wouldn't say that per se, but it is the one where it is like it's very different within the album, because I think one, like, you know, pretty explicitly about race, which like there's plenty of Death Grips songs that are explicitly about race, but this one feels like much more like, okay, intentional.
It's in the verses and the chorus, like it's very front and center in the song, definitely.
Yeah, that's
exactly
one of the other things I wanted to point out earlier is that especially with that, that's another form of the confrontational aspect of this album that I think kind of takes itself on in a way that their other albums didn't. And it's like, again, right there in the title too, wherein they have never to Ride has never to date used that word in any of his lyrics, but it becomes this sort of immediately like confrontational thing by putting it front and center on the album's title. And you like see it reverberate in ways like on here, I would say also on Say Hey Kid, and honestly, like possibly even Voila. There are like kind of little fragments throughout the album where you kind of feel it peeking in and becoming an extra sort of like layer into the different sorts of like paranoias and anxieties and different sort of like cultural stresses that are going on throughout here.
Totally.
And I think in the Tom, it's a reference to a Gil Scott Heron poem,
yes,
if that's correct.
Yeah,
so it is just like, hey, you know, because I feel like that is sort of like, I don't think, obviously Death Grips, I don't think they intended that, but like, you know, very quickly kind of found themselves, despite, you know, it seems like ex-military, the intention was really to kind of go back to like some of this like golden age hip hop and like really revisit it in like a really fresh and unique way and bring it back to its roots as like genuine countercultural music. And that kind of, you know, got easily swept up and eaten by a very much white music press, and so like
an audience, you know, especially.
Yeah,
exactly. So they always felt like they're even despite making like hip-hop, they always felt kind of outside of the genre, outside of the community, because I always felt like it's like, oh well, because it also just didn't help that like, you know, people had our time getting into that music, like obviously you think of Dead and Hip-Hop and like Mike Seatown trying his hardest to like be like, guys, this is good, come on, and them just like not getting it at all. Although I think that the tides changed eventually somewhat. I think like, I know they did,
yes,
a Ginny Death or Bottomless Pit review. It was
no, yeah. I think we referenced this last time. I'm pretty sure it's I forget again which, but they did a review for Ginny Death where they both listened to it and like did it, got what, and it was still like complete bewilderment, and but I think you're totally right that this is like the thing that I really love about this album, how it works with Ginny Death, is because basically I think after Government Plates, there are these two branching paths of like where Death Grips could have gone as the follow-up to Government Plates. And the genius idea they had is like that one little girl from the taco commercial meme. Why don't we have both? You know, like they sort of realized, like, okay, on one hand, we have this like more focused this more like concentrated, abstracted, electronic sound that we've been building with Government Plates. But we've also got the thing that was the root of this, which is the kind of bringing back the rock and roll and bringing back the early hip hop and like the ex-military stuff that really over time, like the subtle electronic accents of ex-military give way into complete like abstract electronics over time. And I think they simultaneously wanted to get back to that raw sound while also being like, we kind of want to take this abstract electronic thing further and see if we can like really, really get out there. And they do both by having this one album that is the first half being this shorter, condensed, just burst of like raw alienation and fucking horror. And then the second half is more fun and more like ex-military, but it's still dark, it's still dealing with the same sort of themes. And I do think that neither Jenny Death nor Redacted on the Moon are my favorite Death Grips album. Jenny Death was close at one point, but it's not quite up there anymore. It's like toward the top middle. But if you combine the things that are working best on Redacted and the things that are working best on Jenny Death, you would have the best Death Grips album. I think across the two discs, and we'll save most of the Jenny Death talk for next week, but like across the two discs, you really get the whole picture of like what this band is going for, what various ideas and techniques they want to really implement. And I think that there is so much going on in both halves of the album. And I think this song, particularly Black Quarterback, is one of the few songs on the album that I don't dislike the song at all. Do not get me wrong. This song is great. I think MC Ride's performance and writing on the song is great, and I think the instrumental is very cool. But this is the first song on the album where my enjoyment of those things feels like it's happening more on paper than it is happening like within my gut and my heart and my chest. You know what I mean? Like, this album is so impenetrable and alienating in a way that I love, 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 love at some points. And then sometimes it's actually alienating where I'm like, I'm on the outside of this. I can admire it as like a very like, I'm really, really impressed with what it's doing. But I'm like, I'm looking at it from the outside rather than being submerged in it. And I think with this song, it's just like, there's so much writing going on in his, and there's so much in his performance going on that when combined with the super dense instrumental underneath it, it very easily can just kind of turn into like, there's nothing I can grab onto here, even though there is so much I can grab onto, you know what I mean? But like, I think even with that mild complaint, like I still, whenever I'm listening to the album in full, none of the tracks that I like slightly less really hamper my enjoyment of the album, because the flow is so good and none of these songs are too long until the very end. Like, they're all pretty. Black Quarterback is 3 minutes. The next couple songs are all like 3 minutes, and within that 3 minutes, it's going all sorts of fucking places. Like, it is not a repetitive 3 minutes at all, even though there are, like you're saying, like, there are these things that keep repeating throughout the album. Themes keep repeating. Motifs in the sampling and the drumming keep repeating. And there are moments where it can feel repetitive in a slightly less enjoyable way. But for the most part, I think it really just hammers home this intense sense of mood and paranoia that they're trying to communicate.
Exactly. But yeah, let's go on to the track number four then, Say Hey Kid. So a little bit of the end of Black Quarterback into Say Hey Kid.
Yeah, this is nasty as fuck. I love this. This is the other one that is grown the most in my esteem listening to it this week. Say Hey Kid is so fucking good.
It might be the nastiest like Zach Hill drum fill he's ever done. Across all projects, like Death Grips, Hella, etc. Like, that's the nastiest drum fill he's ever put out. It's so good.
And then this fucking, like, there are not many hooks on this album. It's easily the least hooky Death Grips album, but I do what my people would, because my people would. Oh, I have had it stuck in my head all fucking week. It's so great. And then also, one of the nastiest synth sounds they've ever made that's about to pop into the mix here in a second is just, oh, this whole song is unbelievable. You do what my people would grunt. Don't it feel right to sell a tent? There it is.
Yes.
It's so corroded and nasty. I use the word nasty to describe so many things on Death Grips albums, but it is nasty as fuck.
I think one of the other things that I think is especially compelling about some of the compositions here is so many of them feel like they don't stay in one place for too long, and this is one of the ones where it's like the dynamics between those like really fast like fill cymbal heavy like drum parts and this like slower menacing like verses that then builds back up in the way that you're hearing right now are just it's just such a fucking compelling way to structure a song. I also want to point out, as we mentioned, the genius annotations are hit or miss, to say the least. So there even within them, there was contention as to what the John and Shelley was. But I especially like the idea that it's John Milton and Mary Shelley, just because of the line that Mary Shelley took for Paradise Lost on the cover of Frankenstein, which is, "Did I request thee, maker, from my clay to mold me, man? Did I solicit thee from darkness to promote me?" Which is, like, in the context of the album, can be read as, like, Ride taking that as an existentialist plea of, like, why he was put into life if he was just going to go through all of this suffering and pain. And it, like, it tracks so well to what the rest of the album is doing.
Absolutely. And I mean, it makes, he's obviously a Mary Shelley fan, like the Gothic poetry, like just take one look at his paintings and tell me that dude doesn't read Mary Shelley. But like, I really love how, like, and then like the neck sucking imagery in this song, I think really helps drive that theory in for me personally. Like, this is very gothic while also being very like gothic cyberpunk. It just fucking rules. I love that synth so much. It sounds like a siren or like, but like kind of like a cell phone alarm also too. Like the way it's all corroded and bit crushed. It's great.
I mean, yeah, this song is, it's been one of my favorites, you know, on the album for some time now. And just one, that drum fill alone, like that already shoots it up to the, you know, not near the top, just alone on that drum fill. But also like this, like, really scathing critique on capitalism, which like, I mean, if you're a fan of Death Grips, like, yeah, no, like it's all over. But like, you know, sort of like being like, hey, like these public service workers, like bus drivers, yeah, they're cool. Like, you know, some people may not support what you do, but like, yeah, no, you're doing something that's good for society. Like, you do you. And then obviously like the neck biting like vampires, you know, is like pretty clearly like rich people think that like poor people leech off of them and whatever the fuck. It's just there's a lot of imagery with this song going on. It's a lot of interpretations you can make here. It's probably like, and also just certain lines just out of context are like kind of funny. Like, don't it feel good to ride a bus or drive a bus? Like, yes.
No, it works on both levels. That's the thing is that Death Grips is always working on multiple levels. They're deadly serious and completely taking the piss out of it at the same time. They are trying to be accessible and kind of catchy. And they're also trying to deliberately, repel people from enjoying their music and are almost sometimes challenging us to enjoy their music despite what they're doing with it. Like, and so I think that's totally, and I definitely do think it is they know it's funny, and I think Death Grips is generally underrated from their sense of humor, because the sense of humor of Death Grips fans is not consistently great. Not of course there are incredible Death Grips memes, because there are just lots of people on the internet who listen to Death Grips, and they are very memeable and shareable, and you can, and also they give out stems for a lot of their music, which helps. But like, I think that in general, like, they, even in this album, which is their most serious, their most dark, their most kind of grave in general, there still are, I mean, the next song on this album is called Have a Sad Come Baby, like,
yeah,
there is that humor and that acid and that social commentary that is never like front and center always. And when it is political like this, they are very, 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 very careful to not hit the nail too directly on the head. They are not idols, no sir. They are never going to be like, capitalism is bad and you shouldn't believe in it. They're going to be a lot more abstract and poetic and mysterious, and that will lead to lots of people arguing about what the song means on the internet, which I'm sure is something that they like. I'm sure they like being indecipherable, being something that they know people are going to project themselves onto, so they release it with no fanfare, no interview, no Stefan talking to some press journalist and saying like, you know, yeah, I've had a really hard last couple of years, you know, and I wanted to make this album that described my mental health struggles. No, they put this shit up on the internet for you to download and for you to interpret. And I think that is the thing that leaves people on this album, is like, you finish this album and you're just like, what the fuck just happened? How do I make sense of that emotionally? How do I make sense of that musically? How do I make sense of that intellectually? Like, it just leaves you gobsmacked in a way that no other Death Grips album does, I think, for better or for worse.
Yeah, there are a few different things I want to touch on there, but I wanted to say that I always, to me, there's something kind of humorous about the delivery of, I guess, her next just the best is like, is such great comedic timing within the context of it. But also to talk about the sort of sense of multiplicity, because this is one of those songs where the lines are so kind of, they're deliberately, I would say, less dense than you would have on something like, say, Billy Not Really or Black Quarterback. But what they're replacing that with is this like very sort of enigmatic vagueness that I think really lends itself to multiple interpretations, just because that read of that capitalist critique is certainly there. But like, to talk about like how I see sort of like the angles that this album is, say, like approaching race coming into it, you could also read into it this sense of like critique of this pressure to be complacent within a sort of very white supremacist culture, where you have to like put on this air of becoming the like perfect public servant and like getting a respectable job where you will be respected in a certain way. And it's, as the song kind of evolves, it like warps that in a way that I find especially fascinating, with where it goes into the sort of like vampirism of the second verse is sort of like an analog of that.
And that's driven home by the chorus, the "I do what my people would because my people would only if my people," which if it's just how he's able to make something that catchy out of just mostly repeating the same words is like genius. But it's also like, I think, a kind of commentary on like, you know, like hetero, not heteronormative, what's the word I'm looking for? Orthodoxy, like the way that like a norm is imposed on a society, and the way that people are meant to conform to these standards and these societies, and the way people are forced to jam themselves into these structures that don't account for like people's differences and that sort of thing. And I really think that that is here. But it's also like, there are five different ways you could read this song.
Exactly.
You could point to different parts of it, different words of it, and it is trying to be all of those and none of those at the same time. And that's the thing that can be frustrating about trying to break this album down, but also is like why I know I will keep coming back to this album and finding more in it, finding more ways to look at it, to understand it, to try to understand it.
Our next song is Have a Sad Come Baby.
There's just there's no good segue for Have a Sad Come, Baby. We just gotta hear that music, baby.
Yeah.
Part of my
also Come Play Dead into Come Have a Sad Come, Baby.
Beautiful. I never. By the way, when you were saying Black Quarterback is the biggest banger on this album, I was like, Say Hey Kid and Sad Have a Sad Come Baby.
Yeah, I should say, yeah, that's
harder bangers.
Well, Black Quarterback keeps it pretty, like, it doesn't, you know, it's full on energy, where at least, like, Say Hey Kid kind of has the verses that are a bit more, like, chilled out a little bit. And then this, obviously, like, this is probably my least favorite track on the album, but it's still, like, really great and really essential. It's still great and it's really essential for the record, but, yeah. Like...
Yeah, my evolution with this album had it where, like, this song and Fuck Me Out used to be my two least favorites, because I felt like they kind of, for a while, they felt kind of not of a place with the rest of the album in terms of, like, lyrical and thematic content, and also just kind of didn't really feel to have as much sort of, like, for me, like, variety and the sort of, like, diction that, like, made the rest of the album really click. But recently, like, as I've sort of started to recontextualize the album and think about it in the sort of like way of thinking of avoiding coping mechanisms and like all of those sorts of things, it becomes this really fascinating like 1-2 where this becomes like a stretch of songs that like pairs together the idea of like sort of like dissociative depersonalization via sex, sort of like doing something to your body as sort of a way to like escape it for a moment. And I feel like that's especially kind of hammered home here, where you have this very abstracted presence of Ride, where he's not even actually really there. It's just reconfigured, chopped up vocal samples of him
Him saying the word blood.
Yes.
Blood. Have a sad call. It's so funny that like this is. There are some Death Grips songs that feel like shitposts in kind of an insubstantial sort of way, where it feels like there are Death Grips songs you will get to later in their discography where it's like, does this song succeed at being something more than just a joke? Is it more than just, is it just a bit, or is it like existing as a bit and also this like important, whatever, like a good song at the same time? And I think this is a great example of one that is like having its cake and eating it too, where like the chorus, quote unquote chorus of the song, which is a sample of someone yelling "Have a sad come, baby," is catchy. Like it works in this insane, weird musical environment that it's existing in, and is remarkably catchy for how just unorthodox it is in its construction, and how this is like the least MC Ride you get on any song this album in terms of his presence on it. And I really like it as a sort of like Gov Plates 2 type track that reminds me of This Is Violence Now and some of my favorite tracks from that album. And so I really, really like this album, like more so than, I like this more than Black Quarterback, more than Fuck Me Out, more than Voila even. Like I really love this track.
Which, yeah, it's. I'll let it go into Fuck Me Out because I don't have a lot to say. It's just it's Have a Sad Come, Baby. It's self-explanatory.
Yeah, I will say one line that's especially great, and there is wasting time feels God before it goes wasting time feels good, which it turns it into this whole idea of like the act of depersonalization, like decentering oneself from it, is like almost a form of like omniscience, which is such a fucking wild metaphor.
Here's the nasty one. This is a real nasty one here. This song,
the horniest Death Grips song to date, for sure.
Up until like probably Year of the Snitch, this is just the nastiest Death Grips song.
It is simultaneously, but
very much intentionally.
Yeah, it's simultaneously the horniest, but also like the most like coldest and like almost sort of antagonistic, just in the sense that it's the idea of Fuck Me Out like being depleted or like possibly just like sapped of like life or energy through the act of sex is just it takes it to its like furthest extreme in the most morbid way that only like Death Grips would do.
Yeah, it's the least sensual song about fucking maybe ever made. Like Death Fuck, Let's Fuck, Just Don't Touch Me, Just Fuck Me. like he's like, I don't want you to touch me, but I need to like satisfy these carnal urges. And that's like, I mean, we're getting at it throughout all this, like it's using it as an escape, but then also like having all these complicated feelings, and the way that like his vocal delivery really hammers at home on the song. It's not my favorite song on the album, just because I feel like the kind of V drum breakdowns on it feel the least inspired of everything. Like it feels the most like reiterative, and I like how that ties it into everything on one side. Like all of the cons of this album are so inextricably tied into the pros of it that I feel bad like critiquing them, because it's like it is just this one slab of music really, more than it is like an album with tracks that you can pick apart and pick your favorites. But like I would say that Black Quarterback, Fuck Me Out, and Voila are my least favorites on the album, just in terms of like how that denseness makes it hard to like enjoy them as songs that I'm really feeling. I'm trying not to use the word visceral, because I use it way too many times in the ex-military episode and I didn't realize, but you know what I mean. Like most Death Grips songs are just like smacking you over the face, as opposed to these ones, which you're having to lean in a little bit more and be like, wait, what the fuck is going on here? And like parse through it. But I still like this song. I think it's not as, it's not piss. We'll just say that.
I will say this part's my favorite part of it, just because this verse is fucking wild, even just to see it transcribed, but to hear it in motion, where you have this full erosion of like any sort of straightforward sentiment, and it becomes this fully repetitive, onomatopoetic, like just nightmare sequence of like different permutations of fuck, different forms of fucking, and it becomes like a sort of immersion in the self-destructive rather than any sort of like glamorization like the rest of it's been doing, but like amplified to a further degree. And also like, just because I gotta like mention anything that reminds me of any sort of poetic allusions, the whole repetition of he she they like as a sort of like fill in the blank for who could be involved here, almost kind of strikes me as like Walt Whitman's Song of Myself, like sort of this repetition of like object or person in the mix there. I also want to point out one of the lines that passed by that I particularly like thought stood out like on this run through is so what you worth, not what you bought, which is almost in its own way a reversal of what we were talking about with the sort of like capitalist critique on Say Hey Kid. It kind of flips the idea of it around, but it does so in such a very sort of fluid way and doesn't dwell on it, and then it's just right back into the haze of fucking.
Yeah, I mean like there are few albums ever made that capture this same experience of being online, where you've got like crude cum jokes side by side with suicidal depression. It's just like, this is what being on twitter.com is like, you know? It's like someone saying like need sucky sucky drippy drippy, and then also people saying like I'm gonna fucking kill myself, like, you know, like what is being online if not that?
Yeah, in reality, if there were an album to be called Death Grips is Online, it would be this one. This is just what my timeline looks like all the time.
But I do really like how it like it turns into that. It seems like it's nonsense, but then if you take a close look at it, like there's the line where it's like fuck buys this, fuck bind spell, we cakewalk, fuck suspect, we foretell, we seance. Like he's saying things and not saying things at the same time, and the lines that are like literally like gibberish and could mean it, be anything, are side by side with the stuff that's meaningful. And that is all to further confuse and disorient the listener and put them in this listening state where you just kind of have to let this album come to you. You can't like expect it to conform to your own expectations in any sort of way. You have to let it wash over you.
Mm-hmm. I want to make one quick comment before we move to the next song. The part where it's like, blah, 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 fuck, wah, 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 fuck. It sounds like the dog playing video. If you don't know what I'm talking about.
Yes.
And then I'll play the Death Grips part again in case you missed it. In case you missed it, if you want to hear the comparison.
Never before have I wished I had the stems to make this mashup happen.
It's the same, folks. It's the same. What can I say? It's the same. But yeah, no, this song is like the thing with sex is that sex is just inherently like really gross. And this song is like, holy shit, it's really gross, but also like just taking the societal view of sex of just just taking that idea that sex is transactional is just taking that to its farthest possible limit of like this completely transactional, like the other person that I'm fucking is just an object. It's just, they're just a sexual object for me to get some kind of satisfaction, some kind of pleasure out of this, and not getting, but even then realizing like you want this, you need this, but not getting any sense of enjoyment out of it. It's wah, 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 fuck, blah, 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 fuck. It's, and also I think there's more F bombs here than in like Uncut Gems. Like there's a lot of F bombs here. MCRI was making this song and Zach and Andy were in the studio like, man, we're not gonna get this on the radio. Fuck, man.
Maddie, with the wah 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 line, do you think MC Riot is Wario? Do you think that's what he's trying? Do you think that's what he's trying to tell us?
MC Riot is Wario. Look. MC Riot, Wario. They're both very tall. They're both very skinny, very lanky. Have you seen Wario and MC
Waluigi?
Oh, never mind, Waluigi.
I thought you were doing a bit for sure.
Have you ever seen Waluigi and MC Riot in the same room?
No.
Didn't think so. But our next song though is Voila, which on an album that's full of like musical magic tricks, here is like, hey, voila, another magic trick.
The drums here.
Also, that drum feels so good, yes. Too, here on here. My proper voila
shadow gambit. My shadow stick monitor off left. And that opening line where he's immediately like turduckening words into themselves.
Yes, exactly.
I know one of the things I didn't get to point out yet is that when this album dropped for the first time, the lyrics for the first time in like Death Grips history, I believe, were not released alongside the album, and at least at first. And so I know for a while, like, there were certain songs that people were just like completely unsure of what the actual lyrics were trying to parse them out until they were like included in the liner notes for the full like Powers That Be album. And I feel like this was one of the ones where it was especially true, just because of how he is manipulating just even the constructions of words as they are being said. My shadow's on to
you. Voila. I love his like restrained delivery on this, and how different it is than something like Get Got, where the restrained delivery is to make room for this very high energy instrumental. It's like this song is so much more haunted the way it's using that, and then the way that the yells come in.
Yeah, I think for me the two key things that this song does lyrically are the sense of, as Maddie was alluding to, this sense of continuing this idea of like any sort of like sleight of hand or like leaning into the enigmatic, the sort of like up my sleeves motif that is being set up at the start of the album, but also this idea of this repetition of my shadow, like the metonymy for what that stands in for, and possibly being almost sort of like Ride's own like shadow self, his sort of like representation of his darkest desires and actions in response to like trauma and pain. And I would also argue that this is the song where you sort of, if we're charting like the arc of the album, this is where he starts to kind of like move his way out of the sort of like especial vulnerability and pain and paranoia, and starts to kind of like confront that side of himself and almost kind of lets it overtake him a bit again.
Yeah, especially the way that like it works as a double album. like the starting run of Jenny Death, which we're not talking about today, but it very much, he goes back into the full like nihilistic I am the beast I worship like cult leader character, and that the confidence returns, but then like that slowly resumes over Voila, that kicks back into power over Voila and Big Dipper, because like, as I'm sure we'll get to with Big Dipper, that song is more back, is kind of the fusion between the braggadocio of the money store and of ex-military with the vulnerability of it. Like the end of this album combines those two sides of, and these two like warring sides of his personality. The part of him that's like, we're in this nihilistic hellscape, and so we're just gonna take over and go crazy and like go get what, take whatever we want, snatch my fetish. But then there's like the part of him that is like, I am a monster, I am broken, I don't think we said it early on, but the line from Up My Sleeves that haunts me the most, I think, is some things only I have seen, some people only I have been, is just like that is hanging over this whole album, even in the moments where it gets completely nonsensical, even in the moments where it will do something kind of funnier or more irreverent or whatever. There's that atmosphere hanging over this whole album, and because it does flow together, like that really does maintain for the entire stretch, even though there are tracks on here I like more than others.
Mm-hmm. But as you said, that, you know, sort of this album, you know, being like the sort of return of the confidence of MC Ride, where it's like there's hints and stuff throughout, but like, well, I was like, okay, like, yeah, I'm a fucking magician, but then here comes Big Dipper, the tip right back into reality, which, again, this album is incredible because it not only has the best Death Grips intro, but it possibly has the best Death Grips outro also.
Yeah, I have said before, and I'll say it again, this is, I've come to terms with this being my favorite Death Grips song, period, just because so much is going on with it. Just to lay down my sort of ways of appreciation, you have this first verse, which is an insane barrage of like free association, but also this really compelling rhyme scheme with assonance going throughout. So you have this like repeated vowel sound of ah 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 throughout the first half of it, and then it flips on the Scarecrow dialect dispatch at like when you're least expecting it. It like has this sort of hairpin turn with like the way that all the words are like constructed together. And also I have to shout out the quite possibly the line that always just kind of makes me go, how the fuck does Ride put these words together, which is I K-Zap slap aristocrat through traffickers of permastock. Like one of those constructions that you just cannot fathom how a human being put that together.
Absolutely.
And like, and it's just, and it's not like lyrical miracle stuff either. It's just like,
no,
there is like meaning behind like why he's putting these things together. Like, one, obviously, like, you know, obviously, like, you know, a rhyme scheme, but also like very purposely putting stuff in there, like planting ideas in the listener's head. And also, again, throwing you off the axis, like, what the hell is he talking about when he comes in with like a harsh bite of reality?
Yeah.
And that hook, that fucking hook. I'm a bullshitter. Shitty stripper, silhouette lifter, struck stuck off kilter, bit bewildered, fucking downer, binge thinner, Big Dipper. Like, just here, this is me. This is what I am. Like, brutally honest, like, I am all of these things.
He contains multitudes.
I love this song. It's not one of my favorite Death Grips closers. Like, I prefer Hacker and Whatever I Want to this, but it is definitely an incredible fucking closer, and the way that it gives way to the Bjork sample at the very end and becomes this instrumental freakout is one of my favorite moments on the album. And I also really, really, really love the outro that leads into that. The it's my pyre, agoraphobe if I want to, afford to be consumed, this pyre is my costume, get too close, it'll lick you like it likes you because it loathes you even more than I do. That's like one of my favorite MC Ride lyrics ever. It's so, so good. Here it is.
I'll get into,
because it loves you even more than I do.
But yeah, so to continue on with like the sort of things that I appreciate in this, especially that idea of like the dynamic structures that I was talking about, especially with like lyrical delivery. The second verse immediately switches up the sort of flow and has it become this elongated structural thing. One of the lines that I think Maddie brought up in the Paste article, the Ursa Major significance minor, is this thing where it's almost kind of like a taunting thing of like, this could mean anything, this could mean nothing. And it's like the one time where I've like entertained an idea that like the rabid self-obsessed Death Grips fans have had, in that like for so long being immersed in that community, so many people were like, whenever there's a full moon, there's a release drop right here. And it would like kept on like that for years, and it just kind of feels like a weird sort of like almost sort of disowning of that notion.
I love how they let they finally really uncork the Bjork. They like let it be as Bjorky as
uncork the Bjork. unofficial podcast title name. Yeah. Uncork the Bjork.
Uncork.
Exactly. Like it's used so like abstractly for so long, but now this is the moment where like, okay, let's let MC Ride get off and let's just like go to town. But also it's like, I kind of imagine that this is just like how Bjork talks in her normal like day to day life. It's like, hey Bjork, what's up? And she just goes, ooh, ah, boop, 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 boop. Like it's just, it's so fucking great. And as I said earlier, like I am as baffled as you are that this isn't my favorite Death Grips album as a Bjork mega stan. And I think in general the implementation of Bjork is, I think a lot of the reviews kind of painted as this gimmicky thing, but I think it's really, and maybe it's because they were like, they heard that Bjork was involved and they were kind of like, oh well, she's not really involved, she's just being used as a sample here. But like, I think it's so interesting the way that they use her, and that, as she said, like it would be weird for to have her as a full creative collaborator, because Death Grips is such a self-contained ecosystem. Like Death Grips is Death Grips. They've done a couple of remixes, including for Bjork early on, but like they are only going to do a remix for someone like Bjork. Like they are, in general, they are their own self-contained ecosystem of just the three of them. And I think this is the Death Grip, despite the fact that they brought in a sort of collaborator by object in the form of Bjork, like this is the most self-contained, isolated, hermetically sealed Death Grips album for sure. Mm. Where it just feels like this thing that has so much going on and that in times is hard to find a way into personally, but then at times it is the most personal Death Grips album. Like it is the one that I associate, and in general I think the powers that be is the most personal material they've ever released, especially with the all of this album and then the last couple of tracks of the powers that be, including on GP especially. But it's just like there's so much contained within this 30 minutes that it's difficult to even I mean, we have podcasted now about this 30 minute album for three times the running length of this album. Like that is how fucking wild this album is.
Yeah, I wanted to touch on sort of like how that track and therefore the album ends too, because I feel like it is the V drum solo full of the Bjork samples, just letting both Zach Hill's skill and the different sort of like vocal maneuvers that Bjork is doing like really sort of sing, is very impressive on its own. But sort of tying together like how it ties together the album is, I think, especially as I was prepping for this, kind of what really hammered home like why it like fits the way it does, especially because that last verse that you were talking about, Jackie, I feel like does kind of like two very interesting things with it. The first is that within the context of the album, it's depicting Ride fully giving himself into like what he's been threatening to kind of become subsumed by for the entire album, in the form of this pyre, which also in its own way bookends the album with this like death ash imagery that's going throughout, and then it leads his like voice echoing out into the Bjork ether, almost kind of being this sort of like funeral march that leaves this kind of like haunting aura of it. But the other aspect of it that I think that like for whatever reason took years to click and did not really hit me until last night is the fact that the thing that he is flipping in this verse of all things is Leslie Gore's It's My Party, which is especially fascinating to me, specifically because you have an album here, that this album that we've been talking about, that is specifically rooted in vulnerability and pain and like hurt emotions. And this is the one touch point that is explicitly drawing from a point of a song about vulnerability. But this is the moment where Ride fully like flips things. This is where he's kind of taken back that vulnerability and he's kind of masked it again. He's shielded himself up, and he instead, in the moment where he's being consumed, makes a point about how he hates you and this fire hates you. And it strikes me as this very sort of deliberate place where he's sort of almost intentionally like refuting the urge to do that and goes back into that sort of mode that he is abandoned and wrestled with for the entire album. And it's this really fascinating dichotomy just in terms of like source and manipulation and subversion.
Yeah, it's a really great depiction of like you're talking about with like avoidance coping mechanisms of irony and nihilism and detachment as a way to put a wall between yourself and pain. And I think that's something that like so many Death Grips fans on the internet, at least I'm interpreting this from the way that like people talk about Death Grips on the internet and the way certain people do, but like I think there's a certain amount of people on the internet that like the kind of irony like shithead like little stinker aspect of Death Grips without recognizing the fact that like I think very actively they are aware of the fact that like their disconnection from reality is this album starts with I was conceived by my disease, right? Like the fact that by the end of it he returns to that kind of that nihilism, that rejection of vulnerability, get too close, it'll lick you like it lights you because it loathes you even more than I do, is after this whole album where he's in this fractured state, but he's kind of letting you in closer. He's also repelling you the entire time. Like this album is giving you a window into Stefan, the person, in a way we never have before, while also making it nearly impossible to connect with initially because of how alienating and strange it is instrumentally.
Yeah. I just, because I've been holding on to this the entire recording, I would be remiss if I didn't bookend this in some kind of way where Jackie was talking about how she had stumbled across the concert footage that I had shot that came up pretty readily. One other form of like my like long lasting legacy is the fact that of all things, this bizarre shitpost I made in like 2015 or whatever in like a haze during like a late night in college where I had like nothing better to do, syncing up the drum solo, the V drum solo at the end of this to like the last scene of Whiplash. I know for a fact that Death Grips has seen it, because they have included it in, of all fucking things, their South by Southwest playlist on YouTube.
That is...
Wait, what?
Yeah! It is... Their South by Southwest playlist on YouTube is, like, six performance videos, one video of Anthony Fantano talking about it, and then at the end, that video for no fucking reason.
That
it's
rules.
Still there.
Oh my god. I guess to book note my final thoughts on this song and this album as a whole, like Big Dipper, obviously the outro with Zach Hill, like I, in some twisted way, I kind of wish this was the last Death Grips album, because I think it would have ended on like a completely perfect note with like some sense of closure in my book, honestly. Like, you know, if we're looking at the last things that Death Grips did, like their last music video is MC Ride dead on a bed. Like he's fallen. The last image is him walking, like basically looking like a ghost in a cemetery, And, you know, the last words are, you know, get close to look to you, but it close you even more than I do. Of like, if you try to get close to me, you're going to get burned. Stay back. You know, like, follow me to the end of this journey. And obviously just this ethereal, like, V-drum outro where it's just all these Bjork samples being thrown at you. Just sort of like you're trying to tether yourself to some kind of reality. And it just keeps throwing you back into the abyss. Just it's just like this album, as you were saying, Jackie, it's not even just Death Grips. There's like there's no album that came before or after this that sounds anything like this, that has any sort of like feeling like this. It is completely of its own thing. It exists in no time, in all time, at the same time. It's just it's masterful. It's a masterpiece.
I agree. I the one thing I will disagree is I do get and actually partly agree with people who say that like, oh, if they had ended after Powers That Be, their legacy would be like untouchable forever. I disagree with I wish Death Grips had just stopped. Like I am glad that they have continued to make music past the Powers That Be, and I will defend a good chunk of the music they've released the past.
Look, I put Steroids in my top five, so
I know.
Here's the thing, it's like I am glad that they continued after this, because even if I don't like all the material as much after this album, like Jenny, that's a still really fun good record. I also think Bookends, the Death Grips are fairly well, but obviously like Bottomless Pit, I have softened on Bottomless Pit. I kind of like Bottomless Pit a lot more now than I did, you know, when it came out, and even years after it came out. And Steroids, obviously, Steroids is incredible, and it shows that Death Grips like still has plenty of ideas in the kitchen that they can go to and really work on. But also the fact that like as of right now, the end of the Death Grips story is Year of the Snitch, which we will not get into. But it's just like that is the only reason I would want Death Grips to continue on at this point. It's just like, I just want them to make something better than Year of the Snitch. Like, don't end your career on this album of all albums. But
Matt is going to get the hose mad again. We need to pull back on the leash. No, but I do agree that even though, like, I think Jenny Death, I'm higher on Jenny Death than you and think it is more important for, like, I do think you really can't. I wouldn't enjoy either of them without the other as much as I do. Like, I love Jenny Death because of how it is different than Redacted on the Moon and vice versa. Like, I think it really does show a two wolves sort of an analysis of here is what's going on in Death Grips music. And I really, even though I would say that in general in their discography, I lean more toward the Jenny Death type material that is a little more straightforward, a little more toward the ex-military rock, the money store type stuff than I do the full abstract. But I also think that, like, you're absolutely right that this is the most singular Death Grips album ever. Redacted on the Moon is like, it's just one of one. Like there will never be anything like this again, because there isn't a performer like MC Ride. There isn't a drummer and musician like Zach Hill. Like, even though there are times this album, I wish the Zach Hill drumming was hitting a little more with that simplicity that you get from some of the other, like I one of the reasons why Billy Not Really is one of my favorite tracks on the album is because of the way that it flips back and forth between the simple drum beat and the insanely complex one. And like, there are some moments of this album that are like so dense that I can get lost in it. But overall, I think that it's just a pretty like totemic work that I understand why it was underappreciated at first glance, but I also am glad that like people have really come to champion it over time more and more, because I think it is really, really special.
Yeah. To close out with my own sort of thoughts on this, but before the series had started and I started kind of like dipping my toes back into the different places in the Death Grips discography, occasionally, like over the years, like mostly since Year of the Snitch, where like was about where my sort of interest in the band kind of faded, I would return to like maybe one or two certain albums every now and again, usually like between each year, and it would usually be stuff like The Money Store or like No Love Deep Web, things that kind of have very sort of singular sounds or impacts or like tracks that really kind of stand out to me. But this one kind of like over time has become the one that like I really sort of feel myself like pulled to over time. I think because of those like singular enigmatic qualities and the different elements of say like the poetics or the production details that are like especially sort of like things that pierce me in a very, very specific like kind of like personal interest way. But also it's felt like because the album even set almost 7 years out now has like not fully revealed its secrets to me, I feel like that's only been something that's pulled me back even more, just because it feels like there is still more that I can get out of this album. There is still like kind of more depths to it or like meanings I can derive out of it that I'm still sort of working through. And in the case of like prep for this is like clear that I'm still sort of like digging through what some of these lines mean and how they like connect in the arc of the album. And I feel like it's been one of those things where for years I have like called this like one of my favorite albums, and every single time I come back to it I like enter into it being like, I don't know if that'll stick. I don't know if like, because my relationship with Death Grips is very much like of a time and a place. And then I like listen to this and I'm sort of like immediately sucked back in and start sort of like find myself fully falling down the rabbit hole of what's going on here. And regardless of like however I will feel about this band, like over the spans of time and whatever may come next for them, this is always the one where I'm like, okay, so I just on like a craft and production level, like this is like a sincere just object of appreciation for me.
Mm-hmm. Unless we had any more thoughts, that is it. That is the episode on Redacted on the Moon. And of course, you know, we're not doing the powers to be combined because that would be like a 5 hour long podcast.
Jesus Christ. No.
We literally may spend an hour alone just on the lead up to Jenny Death. So like be prepared for a very long next episode is all I will say. Mm-hmm. But to save us some time. So they drop Redacted on the Moon, and then a few weeks later, they announce that they're over. They post a breakup note that is written on a napkin. Let me see if I can find it real quick and read off what they said, because this and you know, you can't help but feel like, was this connected to like the lukewarm reviews the album got? Probably not, but like again, I think when we get to the Jenny Death episode, we will like figure out like our own interpretations of what you know, this means. So let me pull up the note real quick. We are now at our best, which put a pin on that.
You were going to bring that up. I was going to do it. I was waiting on you.
Put a pin on that real quick. We are now at our best. And so Death Grips is over. We have officially stopped. All currently scheduled live dates are canceled. Our upcoming double album, The Powers That Be, will still be delivered worldwide later this year via Harvest/Third World Records. Death Grips was and always has been a conceptual art exhibition anchored by sound and vision above and beyond a band, a quote unquote band. To our truest fans, please stay legend. So they put that out, canceled their tour dates. They were supposed to open for Nine Inch Nails on like an arena tour. That
Nine Inch Nails and Soundgarden were replaced by Trix Point Never, I should say.
Yes. But again, that is the thing when it comes to sound that I cannot get over, is that like even Death Grips themselves were like, this is us at our best. And the fact that no one has really took like a look at that and been like, hey, we should maybe see why this band considers this album their best. You know, like that's the most they've really said about this album, is that like, yeah, this is us at our best. That's it. That's all we really know. And I think we should. And I think I'm glad we did this podcast, because I think we did evaluate why that is. But like, this is now, I'm passing the buck off to you all, to the critics, to the listeners. Hey, why does the band consider this the best? Like, let's talk about this. Let's have a conversation, which is why I'm glad that Pace let me be on my bullshit, put this at number one, because like, it is their best album to me. Like, this is the band at their best, where their ideas and creativity were just the most fruitful and the most like, just again, nothing sounds like this. Nothing has sounded like it since. It is a record that like is not influential, but because no one knows how the fuck to recreate even like the minor elements of it. It's incredible. I really do hope once we hit like the 10-year anniversary, like this album really does get a full blown reevaluation. Hopefully by that point, some publication allows me to do such a thing. But yeah, so Death Grips, they broke up, or they are over. And at the time, I thought this like breakup note was kind of pretentious, and it kind of is, but that just, it comes with the territory of Death Grips. Like, yeah, of course, they're like, they don't want to call themselves a band. They're like, yeah, we're an art exhibition. Like, it's like, not wrong. Like, they're not wrong. But I think of this note not that often, but like now, like I think it's an important thing before we move on with the rest of the series. Like that this is a Chekhov's gun. Okay. Like pay attention to this note.
There are multiple points within this note that will come up again, that will be debated again, like whether or not Death Grips is a band, whether it matters, whether Death Grips is just a band or whether they are something more. Like all of this stuff is stuff that is, it really sets the table for the rest of what we're going to talk about for this series. What is Death Grips post Powers That Be? Powers That Be ends with Death Grips 2.0. Like we're going to get into all of this, but I think this is really, it is the tipping point for their career. And I think it's also perfect that we are doing these as two separate episodes, not only because if we tried to do a whole Powers That Be episode, it'd be the longest podcast of all time, but also because like, this is a true double album. Like they were released separately for a reason. Like these two albums are, it's not like something like Summertime 06 where it's like there are two discs to it and those two discs like are separate, but really you could rearrange them. You could have songs from disc one on disc two and like nothing, no one would really know the difference. Where this one, it's like none of the songs on Redacted on the Moon would make sense on Jenny Death and vice versa. Like they are so distinct, so separate, and so complementary in my opinion, that I think it's really great that we're gonna get that over time we've come to appreciate both of them as these singular achievements in their discography. And I'm very excited to get into that all next week with special guest goddamn Boo Cannon is gonna be on the podcast, which is gonna be so much fun. Very excited to have her on. Very excited to have had Natalie on for this episode. What a treat.
Yeah, it was a delight to get to talk about this album that has still perpetually had my brainworms running for close to 7 years now. So thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, we talked about it for an hour and a half, and I feel like I understand more and less about it than I did at the start, which is all you can really say about this album.
Yeah, that's been my relationship to it, like, each subsequent year.
Exactly. So, yeah, that's it. Hopefully you all enjoy this episode. You're not going to notice it because we're putting these out weekly, but we're taking a little recording break. This is our sixth episode that we've recorded within, like, a 2 to 3 week span. Closer to 2 weeks than 3 weeks, so... we are taking a little breather because I'll be away, and but of course you're not gonna notice it all because you know we'll have these going out weekly. So I'm glad at least personally be taking a little bit of a breather before hopping back in, because I feel like this is you know, like this is in terms of the main, like the first act of the Death Grips arc, like this is the first act that this is completed, you know. And so I'm excited to move on to act two, Jenny Death, which like I said, prepare for a very long episode, folks. Prepare for a very long episode and for a lot of yelling and disagreements and back and forth, because the contentiousness, this is where it begins. So
it's about to take a sharp uptick.
Yes. If you like to get mad at the computer, you're gonna love these next couple episodes of the series. But that'll do it for us this week. Hopefully you all enjoyed this episode. Natalie, is there anything you want to plug before we close off?
Not really. At time of recording, I'm kind of in like dead zone with stuff. But this was fun. This was plug enough.
Alrighty. Hopefully you all enjoyed. We will see y'all next week, and bye-bye.
Have a sad come, baby.
Have a sad cum, baby. Have the saddest cum you've ever had in your entire life, baby. Bye bye.
It's my pyre, agoraphobe, if I want to afford to be consumed. This pyre's my costume, get too close, it'll lick you like it likes you, cause it loathes you even more than I do. We'll be right back.